Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, the Grand Circle Tour podcast is about to air right this moment. Please remain seated and keep your seatbelt fastened at all times. Thank you.
The Disneyland Limited, now leaving for a Grand Circle Tour of the Magic Kingdom. All passengers board.
Star Tours announces the boarding of the Endor Express. All passengers, please prepare for immediate boarding.
Please stand clear of the doors. Por favor, manténganse alejado de las puertas.
To those guests who've just joined us, welcome. For those of you standing, please hold on to the handrails throughout our journey and stay clear of the doors.
Please keep your hands, arms, and legs inside the train and remain seated at all times. Hang on to them hats and glasses, because this here's the wildest ride in the wilderness.
I am Sam the American Eagle, and I am proud to introduce the Grand Circle Tour Podcast, a celebration of Disney parks, but mostly the American ones. I really like these guys.
Welcome to this edition of the Grand Circle Tour Podcast. My name is Caroline, and I'm so glad you've joined us this evening. Tonight, I am joined by George and Stan. How are you doing, guys?
Doing good.
I'm great.
Good. What's up with you, George?
My what's up for tonight actually occurred yesterday. I took the whole family to see the live-action Lion King.
And, great.
And I'm definitely going to save, my comments for the movie review. I can't wait to talk about it. Because a lot of people had mixed reviews online. But all I pretty much will say is I did enjoy the movie.
That's great to hear. And Stan, what about you?
I actually went to Lion King this morning. And I'm going to hold my review for tomorrow. I'm not going to say one way at all, whether I liked it or didn't like it or was indifferent. I'm going to save it all. I'm going to keep it all a mystery. But my waltz up is I've been collecting the Galaxy's Edge comic books that were put out by Marvel. And they're really cool. They basically started off with each episode is the Hammerhead character that has the little curio shop on Galaxy's Edge. He has different things in the shop. So each episode, they kind of pick one item from that shop, each issue, and they pick one item from the shop. And they tell you how he acquired that item. And it's a fun read. It really is. If you're a big Star Wars fan and planning on going to Galaxy's Edge, or even if you're not and you're a Disney fan, I'm planning going to Galaxy's Edge. It's worth checking out just to see, the history behind it. It's, how Disney's all about theming? Well, this land is very much about theming, and you get that story, and you get the backstory on individual items, which is really cool.
Oh, that sounds really neat. All right, you guys. So tonight we're going to talk about going to Walt Disney World and making it a wonderful time. We've all looked around and seen people having meltdowns at Disney World or Disneyland. And it just seems like the last place on earth that you would want to have a meltdown. And we know that you've spent a lot of money to get there. So tonight we're going to talk about some tips that we have to make it the best trip to avoid meltdowns. And also some things, if you did those, you're probably going to have a meltdown. So does anybody want to start in particular with their tips?
Well, the first thing that I have to say is normally when I see a family that have a lot of that smackdown, brutal meltdown is what I like to call it.
Yeah.
I usually kind of pinpoint them as, and I hate using this title, but possibly rookies or newbie.
Okay.
To the park, because a lot of times families don't really know what they're getting into as far as going to the parks. So a family for the first time could be thinking, okay, well, we'll wait in line, go to this attraction. How hard could it be? Well, if you're not used to doing it or it's your first time and you're completely lost, you have all that pressure on you. The kids, end up getting all kerbobbled, especially during the time, if you go during the summer times, extreme heat, you have kids out in the day, especially if you have little ones. And one of my biggest tips that I say, even if you're a newbie or if you're a regular, if you're seasoned or whatever, I definitely say is definitely take breaks in between.
Excellent tip. Excellent tip. Excellent.
Yeah. I don't really say, you know, yes, you do want to get your money's worth. You want to see as much as you can, but sometimes that could come back and haunt you that if you just try to push for every little thing, you know, pace yourself, do a little bit, you know, go in the morning, maybe do rope drop. If you want to start out early in the morning, get as many rides as you possibly can. Then maybe in the afternoon, go back to your hotel, you know, take a swim in the pool, get a bite to eat, you know, and then go back into the early evening to the parks.
That's such a great tip. I think people, you can't do it all for sure. And people lose sight of, people get tired and then that's when they lose their tempers. And that's when the whining and the, or even the adult bad behavior begins. What about you, Stan? Do you have a tip?
Yeah, I'm going to comment a little bit on what George said. He was talking about newbies or people going for the first time or haven't been in a very long time. I would start before you even do your trip is plan it. Plan your trip out. And if you're listening to this podcast and you haven't been to Disney World before, you haven't planned a trip in a really long time, you're already off to a great start because that means you're out there and you're looking for tips and you're trying to get ideas as to what to expect before you step foot in the park or before you get to Orlando or California. And I think that planning is crucial. Book your reservations for dining as early as you can. Book your fast passes as early as you can. Kind of plan each day where you're going to spend in each park. And from that, that would be where you book your fast passes, where you book your dining. I think that that's a great tip to kind of, you know, prepare yourself before you even leave home.
Education is key. I say go with knowledge. And I think that will even help you having a better time. I'm going to go back to what George has to say. And I'm going to say sleep is really important, even when you're at Disney World. So if you're going to be at rope drop, my tip is that's great. Go to rope, be there before rope drop, but do not stay until the park closes that same day. Get to bed early so that you can be refreshed and you are a pleasant person to be around. So I think factor sleep into your vacation because you are going to need it. Another really simple tip that I have is the shoes that you wear, break them in before you go. Do not buy yourself new shoes to wear to the parks. You are only asking for trouble. And also bring some blister pads or Band-Aids and keep them in your purse or in your pockets or something in case you do get blisters. Because if your feet are sore, and that's going to make it harder for you to be a nice, pleasant person. So that's one of my really simple tips is break in your shoes before you get there and bring something in case you get blisters.
Yeah, I've always gotten blisters at Walt Disney World. Every trip I go, and I have a job where I'm on my feet 9 hours a day, and Disney World, for whatever reason, with the heat and the sweat and the extra walking, every single time I've always had blisters, no matter how broken in my shoes were. And I've always worn a certain brand of shoe, and I decided to go to one of these running room type stores, and they measured my walk, and she saw what type of walk I had without shoes on. And then she picked out a pair of shoes for me, like the clerk there. And it was a little bit more expensive doing it that way versus going to, say, a Foot Locker or you know, pick your own shoes off the shelf store. But she gave me a pair of shoes to try on, the first pair. She brought out several. And the first pair I tried on, they fit amazingly. It was unbelievable how nice they felt. So I wore them for about a month before I went to Walt Disney World. And what a difference it made. Not one blister, and I've been wearing that same brand now, which is a different brand than I've worn my entire life. And it's my brand might not match your feet. I mean, she measured my walk and saw what type of walk I had and knew what I would need. You might need something different to me. So I'm not going to be mentioning brands because I don't want you running out and getting that brand because it might not work for you. But go see someone that knows feet and pick out shoes that are meant for you.
I definitely can relate, because there was one time and I was completely, and I usually don't get irritated being at Disney, but this one time I was, because I wasn't wearing the proper foot gear. And at the time there, and I don't know how it is now, but there's not one place in Walt Disney World that sells shoes. I kid you not. I was around every single store. Not one place had just a decent pair of shoes. And then there was one store at the time, it was Downtown Disney before it became Disney Springs, that had a decent pair of slip-on shoes. They were the ugliest pair of shoes I've ever seen in my life. They were blue and red striped slip-on shoes. They looked like grandpa shoes.
And do you still have them?
No, I burned them. But despite of how bad they look, they actually got me through the rest of the trip. And yes, I definitely agree with it. Bring comfortable pairs of shoes.
Yeah, and one person in your party having bad blisters could ruin it for the, not ruin it, but it'd make it more difficult for everyone else in the party, because they're uncomfortable, you're going to be uncomfortable.
Absolutely.
That's okay, a great tip.
I have another really quick tip. My tips are pretty simple. Water, 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 water. You got to drink water. And I don't care if you go in January, you've got to drink water. It's a huge place. You're going to be trekking a lot of miles. And you don't have to lug around bottles of water. At every quick service place, you can go in and ask them for a cup of complimentary water, and they will happily give it to you. So hydrate, 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 and they have bathrooms everywhere. So anyway, but hydrate is my other really important tip that will keep you a pleasant person.
That was actually one of my tips. It was definitely stay hydrated, but more so drink water. You know, if you can stay away from as much sugar, you know, and sodas as possible, especially with kids, because, you know, hitting a lot of people think, okay, well, I'll give them sugar, they'll be hyped up for the day, you know, but when when it comes to the call, they crash. And before the crash, you get the ugly tantrums.
Right. Yeah. Do you want to say something, Stan?
Yeah, just to carry off what you were saying, Caroline, about every quick service, Disney World is getting better and better. And I believe every single mobile ordering spot, which is pretty much every quick service now, they have cups of water there for you to just walk up and grab. You don't even have to ask anymore, it seems. Oh. I mean, you can kind of nod to them when you take one or two. But you just go to the mobile ordering side of the counter. You don't have to stand in that massive line at Casey's anymore. You go off to the far right, and they have the quick service. And I used to bring a water bottle with me all the time, and I would fill it up every chance I got. Now what I do is pretty much every single time I walk past a quick service restaurant, I pop in and grab a cup of water for myself.
Yeah, that's great.
And then kind of added on to that, before Epcot goes through this transformation and everything and the overhaul and upgrades and everything, I would definitely say utilize buildings with air condition, you know, to take your kids in, you know, anywhere that you can, it has air condition, just take them in, sit down, take a little rest, you know, let them cool down. But the reason you're probably wondering why I say Epcot is before they do the change and everything, if you really want to get your kids' attention, you take them in, you give them air condition, and you give them a beverage called Beverly. And I guarantee you, you'll have their undivided attention afterwards.
Oh my goodness. You're so funny, George. Oh my goodness. Okay. Another basic that I have, I know this seems kind of silly, but sunscreen. You got to wear sunscreen, because if you have, I see people walking around and they have this red, red skin and they're miserable, and you got to wear it all year there. I just can't stress it enough, because you don't want things like a sunburn and blisters on your feet and being dehydrated, just really simple things to ruin your vacation. And it's it's kind of a little bit of a stressful vacation because there's so many people. You got to pay attention to what you're doing and you want to get it all in. So just taking care of these basic needs are going to help you be a more pleasant person and be able to navigate what's happening at the parks. Do you guys have anything to say on that or anything else?
Yeah, just like sore feet, having a sunburn is very uncomfortable and very painful and can make your trip very miserable, your vacation very miserable. And you don't want to be a red lobster in all your photos. You don't want to be skin peeling.
Yeah, we had that closer to the end of our trip, thank God. But we just got off the Disney Dream for the Disney Cruise Line. And my wife and I got scorched on Castaway Key, for which we did not know. And we ended up going to the heating chairs at the Census Spa. So imagine having a sunburn and then sitting and taking a nap on a heated chair.
Oh my gosh.
So by the time we got back to Walt Disney World, because we did a Walt Disney World trip, Disney Cruise Line, and then Walt Disney World again. By the time we got back to Walt Disney World, for some reason, we were coming across anything that would aggravate the sunburn when we went to go meet Mike and Solly. And Beast, let's just say that when they went to give us hugs, they have claws. So that didn't transpire well. And going on Dinosaur, you don't really think that's too much of a rough ride, but try going on Dinosaur with a sunburn. That's
Oh, and it is a rough ride. So, oh, that would be awful. Oh, oh.
How about Space Mountain? That'd be even worse, probably.
Oh. Well, do you all have any other tips for people to help make it a more pleasant vacation and to not have meltdowns, keep the meltdowns at bay?
Well, just while we're still on the topic with sunscreen or sunblock, I like when you see the footprints in the sidewalk and there's like a spray around it. That's from when a kid is standing there and one of the parents, they use that spray sunblock and they spray the kid entirely and it all lands on the, like some of it lands on the sidewalk and then the kid walks away and you see these two footprints on the sidewalk. It's every time I see that, I go, there's good parents there. They sprayed their kid.
I never seen it. It actually lands on the ground.
Well, yeah, because they spray it and there's a mist when they spray. Some of it actually doesn't land on the child. It lands on the ground. So when the kid moves, where the cement is wet or moist, except for where the footprints were, and every once in a while you'll come across and you'll see these two white footprints with a mist around it, just on the cement. And you keep your eyes open for it. Look up, look down, look around, and you'll see different things. It doesn't last long. It you know, next time it rains, it washes away. But it's kind of cute to see. You see that a lot at the resorts before people get on the buses. You'll see the footprints with the spray around it.
Go ahead, George. I'm sorry.
No, you're fine. I was just going to say, I know I kind of said it as a joke before, but I still stand by, you know, even just if you don't have any kids, as far as like with the air conditioned buildings and everything. And that's the one thing that Disney does a lot of, especially with Walt Disney World. Not too much with Disneyland, but it's more so the fact that they have a lot of indoor attractions as far as with, Disneyland does, but I mean, Walt Disney World has more shows and everything where you can actually go in, sit down, you know, take a break. So that is one plus side of not having a lot of attractions completely outdoors.
Yes, for sure. Mm-hmm.
Another tip I'd like to mention is if you're traveling with a large group, don't plan every minute to be together. If you're two families traveling together, or if you have kids that are like 18 even or older and they can be on their own, split up. You don't have to be a group of seven or eight together the entire time, because that's going to wear on each other's nerves very quickly. Even if you're two couples going, plan time to spend just with your own spouse and let them spend some time with their spouse and split up a little bit. You can meet up for dinner. You can meet up for lunch. Say, you know what, let's meet up at such and such a restaurant at noon, or at, well, don't go at noon because it's going to be busy. go at 11, go at 2. It won't be as busy at the restaurant at that time. Or if you have a dining reservation, you can meet up for the dining reservation. And what that does is it gives you something to talk about, how your day went, and you can talk to each other over dinner. Well, we saw this. Did you happen to see that? We ruled this attraction. We saw this in the souvenir shop. And I think that's something that often people will do when they go together. They think it's going to be a magical time to be together this whole week and a half, whatever, however long you're going, and it never works. I've ever to hear somebody come back and they say, we spent every minute together and loved it. I've never, ever heard anybody say that. But I have heard people say that, we know what, we sped up and we got together for lunch and had a great time.
And I will say also, too, this may sound a bit overrated, but especially if you have kids and you are going to Disney, that a lot of the times, not every time, but the children is the reflection of the parent. If you can keep yourself calm and enjoy yourself and have fun with it and stay engaged, the kids will.
Amen. I have another tip. I say, if your child, don't be embarrassed to rent a stroller if you need to. If you've got an 8-year-old that needs to get in one of those double strollers, push them around because they've had too much or whatever. I wouldn't hesitate to rent one of those strollers if you think, oh my gosh, this is just going to be a whole lot easier if for this child to ride around in that stroller. It will be fine. It is not any big deal. And then my other tip is manage your expectations. That's usually when people get upset, is because, you know, in all the commercials for Disney World, if you look, there are hardly any people in them. Just that cute little family that they, and a few sprinkled in the back. Well, that's not reality. That's not how it is. There are a ton of people there. So manage your expectations in that it's going to be crowded. It's going to be hot. We're not going to be able to do everything. As going back to the beginning of this podcast, and have the few things that you wanted to, that are really important to you, that those are your things that you're going to do. And also, before you go, you can see Space Mountain is going to be closed while you're there. So don't get mad when you're there. Know that before you go. They have a list of what is available. So if you can manage your expectations, like just like in life, you know, that's when we get disappointed, is when reality doesn't meet our expectations. So those are my best tips about having the best time there. If you take care of those basic things, you really will go there and have a wonderful time. Do you all have more to add to that?
And yeah, actually adding on to yours, with that notion of looking up, you know, lists or and everything, even though that you can plan that, Disney World and even Disneyland, they're wildly popular, you know, with people coming in and out all day. Anything can happen at any time. You know, the parks are open literally 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. Rides break down. You know, all stuff happens. So always go in with alternatives. So for the sake of that, even if you say, okay, well, this ride is open, but just in case, if we can't make it, if the line's too long, we can't get fast passes, if it breaks down, we'll create an alternative to say, okay, well, let's go do this. And that kind of goes back to what I was saying. If you keep yourself calm, then I won't even just say your kids, but the family, the whole family stays calm.
Yeah.
Right on, George.
Yeah, and like you were talking about strollers also, you know what? You're never going to see these people again. Your 8-year-old needs to ride a stroller because your 8-year-old gets tired easily and can't do, you know, 10 miles of walking in one day. And honestly, I can't either, but I still do it. But if no one's going to look at you anyways because they're too busy with their own lives.
Right.
But if somebody does, you're never going to see these people ever again. So you don't have to worry about it. Like, there's no peer pressure when you're in a vacation like this. So I wouldn't be afraid of that at all. The other tip too, about setting your level of expectation, you're going to have so much to do that if you miss something, it's going to be there next time you come back. Probably, maybe not, but it probably will be there when you come back the next time. If Haunted Mansion is down, it's not the end of the world. And if this is your one and only trip of your entire life, then you know what? life goes on. That's kind of how you have to look at it. But you can't do it all on one trip. You can't. It is impossible to do it all on one trip, especially Walt Disney World. You can't. Disneyland, even then, you can't do it all on one trip in Disneyland. You're not doing it all. But do what you want to do. And if you can't do it because of, you know, breakdowns or whatever, you have to roll with the punches. You know, pack your patience.
You can't do it all, but what you can do, you can do and have the most wonderful time with and make great memories. And then, you know, and then enjoy while you're there. So it's a really fabulous, wonderful place to go. Obviously, if there's three adults sitting here talking to you about it, telling you how much we want you to have fun there. So take care of this basic stuff. And I know that you're going to have the most magical time. Did you all have anything else that you want to offer?
And I will say that if you want to express your feelings, that if you do get frustrated, the best way to do it is the Disney way. Take yourself into the Main Street Emporium and buy yourself a Grumpy or Donald shirt.
There you go. And maybe get a Mickey bar too. Eat your feelings.
And if it's so hot out that your Mickey bar falls, don't cry. Don't get upset. Don't freak out. Let the cast member know that my Mickey bell melted before I got a chance to eat it. And they'll give you another one. You know, just don't take advantage of it. But
that's what I should have said. I should have went to a cast member and said, shoot, I dropped my Disney vacation package. Can I have another one, please?
Oh, my gosh, you guys.
I saw a guy in one of the restaurants, and he's bringing his food to his table. I guess his girlfriend or wife, whatever, just happened to bump him or whatever, and the food went flying. The hamburger landed on the ground. The drink fell on the tray. And rather than being a normal human being and just going back and saying, you know what, an accident happened, our food, you know darn well Disney's going to replace it. They're not going to say, oh, well, you buy another one if you want. No, they're going to replace it. Instead, what this guy did was completely lose it on her. I felt so bad for her and the little boy too. And he stormed off and he was just freaking mad. I'd never seen anybody so mad in my life. And it was all for nothing. It was just a matter of, you know what, pack your patience, explain the situation to a cast member, it will be taken care of, for gosh sakes.
I love that line, pack your patience. I love that.
Yeah.
Go there and treat people the way you want to be treated.
And while you're buying stuff in the stores, rather than being a pack mule, stay on property. If you can afford it. I mean, there's value resorts. I stay in a value resort. I'm not, you know, ashamed or too proud to say I don't. Stay at a value resort if you have to, but stay on property. Have your packages shipped to your resort. It saves you having to lug around, you know, this giant snow globe for the entire day. And while you're at it, if you want, wait until closer to the end of your vacation and buy your souvenirs then. Don't buy the first thing you see first day, because you're going to see it another 20 times by the end of your trip. So kind of, pace yourself, I guess you could say. Now, if it's something that's in Epcot, that's only going to be in Epcot, you're going to have to buy it then and have it shipped to your room, to your resort. But for the most part, the Disney park souvenirs you can find anywhere on property.
Yeah, and I kind of going off what you were saying, Stan, really quick, that I would definitely say if there's ever a time that, you know, you do feel stressed out, or the cast members are there to help. Yeah. Majority of the time that they may not be able to exceed your expectations, a lot of times they do, but they can at least try to mend that, like with a Band-Aid cover, so to speak. You know, if you do need something.
Yeah, exactly. They're there to help you, and they will.
But a pleasant attitude is a really wonderful thing.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah. So do you guys have anything else to mention tonight before we go?
Yeah. Leaving the park is always, there's three ways you can leave the park. You can leave very early. If you're using Disney transportation and beat the crowd, then you miss you know, the nighttime extravaganza, whether it be Illuminations, which will soon be gone, or Wishes, which is now gone. You know, any of the fireworks shows that they have, you're going to miss them if you leave early. The other option you have is you wait near the exit, and after the fireworks are over, you race to the bus to beat the crowd, but everyone else is doing that as well. Your third option is you watch the nighttime extravaganza, and you start heading back to the buses with the massive crowd that's going to be with you leaving the park. Then you're going to stand in line and watch 3, 4, 5 buses come and pick up people in line that not you, because you're at the back of the line because they all left early and they're still waiting in line. So you're going to be waiting in line for a very long time. What I like to do is I hang back. I wait till the crowd kind of thins. If I'm at Epcot, I'll do an entire loop or half a loop around World Showcase. If I'm at Magic Kingdom, I'll go and get a corn dog nuggets at Casey's, or spring rolls, or whatever I can to keep by. My Dole Whip is great to have if it's still open. Stuff like that to kind of just kill some time while I wait for the crowds to thin out. Then I get to the bus, and there's still a lineup at the bus, but it's not as big of a lineup. And you know what? I stayed back an extra half hour, an extra 45 minutes. Yes, I lost that much in sleep, but I think the payoff is saves myself anyways, who doesn't like extremely crowded lines and buses, from having that stress. So find ways to avoid stress if you can.
That's a great tip. George, do you have anything else to add?
I think I'm good. I guess my closing statement would be, if you're anywhere and you happen to see blue and red striped shoes, stay away from them.
That's fantastic. Thank you all for joining us on the Grand Circle Tour podcast. We are so thankful and appreciative that you did. And we want you to go to the parks and have the most magical time. So we hope that these tips can help you in some way. Have a wonderful day.
Good night, everyone.
And we'll take it away, Ken.
If you would like to keep the adventure going after the show, be sure to like our Facebook friends page, Grand Circle Tour Magical Ticket Holders. While on Facebook, like our group page, Grand Circle Tour. Be sure to follow us on Twitter, Grand Circle Tour Podcast, as well as Instagram, GCT Podcast, and our YouTube channel, Grand Circle Tour. If you would like to send us a message, you can email us at gctpodcast@gmail.com. T-shirts and other fun merchandise can be found at tpublic.com. Simply search Grand Circle Tour Podcast. If you enjoyed your adventure, leave us a review on Apple Podcasts. Only one rule, make it good. Thank you for riding with us, and welcome home.
The aura of something terrible stands sentinel in the night sky. What happened to this once luxurious retreat? The answer lies firmly within the Twilight Zone. The question remains, are you brave enough to find out the secret hidden within this hotel? The Twilight Zone Tower of Terror.